when COVID started really hitting in the UK, there started being a whole host of conversations around how engineers and people with expertise in technology development and manufacturing could start trying to support the healthcare system. Here at UCL, we've got a really nice collaborative setup where we have really strong links between the engineering community and the healthcare community through the hospitals. So we already had really strong links with the University College London hospitals. So what we did was basically go for a drink with them and have a chat around what they really thought we needed in terms of devices and technologies to support intensive care units in the UK through the COVID surge. When patients presented at hospital needing intensive care, suffering with COVID, what they really need is to get more oxygen into their lungs. So they have respiratory failure and essentially need to get more oxygen into their bloodstream to enable them to survive. Now, one way of doing this for the most sick of patients is through ventilators and through mechanical ventilators. But these are really invasive, so they require the patient to be sedated for a long period of time, potentially 2-3 weeks. And they require really close monitoring and input from a highly trained healthcare worker. And now the data that was coming out of Italy and China at the time indicated that if instead you used non-invasive ventilation methods, then we had the potential to alleviate around 50 to 60% of patients from progressing to needing mechanical ventilation. But we don't have, or we didn't at the time, have enough of these non-invasive ventilation devices in the UK to supply the National Health Service. So we quite quickly started thinking about how we could try and build capacity with non-invasive ventilators within the NHS. And specifically, we were thinking about devices called CPAPs, which are continuous positive airway pressure devices. What these devices do is essentially enable you to deliver pressurized oxygen through a face mask. And that pressurized oxygen essentially splits open the lung bases and enables you to get more oxygen into the patient's lungs and bloodstream. Now, one of the advantages of these CPAPs is that usually treatment takes around 3 to 4 days. And it's also in general a lot easier to train healthcare workers to use the devices. We went back to a historic device called the Respironics Whisperflow, which is an off-patent device that had been used very widely in the UK up to around 15 years ago.
Becky picked up a couple of examples of the device that they were looking at. And literally had gone back into sort of storage and found devices that had not seen the light of day for quite a number of years. I think also one of them was actually taken out of the they have almost like a museum of some of the old equipment that they used to use.
So the surge for COVID was coming and coming quickly, and so if we were going to contribute something useful, we needed to be able to manufacture these devices at scale within, you know, a couple of weeks was the time scales that we set for ourselves. And I think one of the other really important points was that we knew we needed to be able to get regulator approval and support for what we were doing, which meant that we took the approach where we started from an off-patent device that had been used already in the NHS, because we knew that that would obviously, if we could demonstrate like for like with that device, that would be acceptable to the regulator. And that was really a key step in enabling us to progress.
To do this quickly, we needed the skills of the motorsports industry, that they can manufacture and produce high quality engineering in a very short time frame. It's also important to say that those relationships were already formed. So whilst perhaps other groups were still talking about non-disclosure agreements, we were able to, you know, within 24 hours, we had our team together. And as soon as we saw this device, we realised, you know, this is it, we can do this. We've got very close links in particular with Mercedes AMG HPP, which in short term is the group that builds the engines for Lewis Hamilton for the Formula One team. So I got in touch with the head of mechanical engineering there, who I know very well. And I sort of suggest my wish was, you know, could you come along for a couple of days to work on the design of this device? What we got back in return was even more than we could have hoped for, because their managing director, Andy Cowell, came back and said, I think the exact message was, do not hesitate to call upon the might of what we can do. The reverse engineering process is to go from the actual parts into 3D or three dimensions of a virtual design, then turn that into two-dimensional drawings, which are then used for manufacture. So our aim was to go from the start of that process to cutting material within 24 hours. We missed it by a couple of hours, and it still took about another 36 hours before we had all of the designs ready for manufacture.
The only reason that we were really able to move quickly was that we had all of these relationships and partnerships already in place. So we knew the clinical teams, we had the engineering expertise, and we had the manufacturing capability. But for example, it meant that when it got to the point that Mercedes were manufacturing the first devices and that they had a few ready, they jumped in a car down here to London, parked up in the UCL quad, and we were in UCLH hospital on the seventh floor there, with the clinical teams from the intensive care unit plugging the devices into the hospital oxygen supply networks and testing them. And really, because we had this whole team in place where we had the clinical representation, the engineers and the industry and manufacturing, it really meant that we could move all of that very quickly and seamlessly. We had volunteers in the hospital setting who had the devices on, they were breathing through the masks, and we were essentially testing to see whether the devices were performing the way that they should do and the way that we anticipated they would. At that point, we could then make our first submission to the regulator. We were demonstrating like for like in terms of performance of our CPAP devices compared to the original Whisperflow one, and also presenting our healthy volunteer test data and our plans for a clinical evaluation. Remember, we submitted that to the regulator within 10 days of that initial meeting. We got approval for the device very quickly too, so virtually immediately. We started talking to the Cabinet Office and the Department of Health and Social Care. We were having a Zoom call with them, and quite quickly the conversations progressed, and they put in an order for up to 10,000 of the devices. So Mercedes were able to produce these devices at a rate of up to 1,000 a day. So we knew we could deliver on these kind of volume of numbers. We've started getting an increasing number of contacts coming in from hospitals across the UK, but then also internationally around getting access to the devices. We released all of the designs and manufacturing processes at zero cost to enable the international community to start manufacturing them themselves. Within a couple of weeks now, we've had over 1,800 approved downloads, and that's across over 100 countries, which is phenomenal. And it's also been amazing to see that different countries are starting to now produce their own versions of the CPAP devices and prototypes. And we're now getting kind of photos from, for example, Kenya or Canada, Russia and Bulgaria, where people are sending in their kind of initial prototypes. So I think to date, we've supplied devices and consumables to over 40 hospitals. From the beginning, you know, our complete motivations with this were to be able to contribute and do something that would help in the kind of COVID fight.
From seeing the device for the very first time, we went from that part of the project through to making the first prototype and being back in hospital for testing within 100 hours. And then within 10 days, we'd actually taken that prototype through the approval process with the MHRA. In that first meeting we had, if we'd been told that within 4 weeks, we want you to manufacture 10,000 of these units, that would have been probably too much to take on board, and we would have had a different mindset. To have delivered that 10,000 within 4 weeks, looking back on it, it was, you know, it's an incredible achievement. Within, you know, 2.5 days, we were starting to run out of essentials. So we sent one of the younger members of the team up to sort of King's Cross St Pancras to go and see what they could find. We could have had sort of like, you know, nice white kind of sort of dress shirts or pajama tops or these bright pink t-shirts. And we got the bright pink t-shirt. It had something like Tropicana.
Yeah, it had palm trees and then like Ventura.
And then Ventura was the logo. And that's where the name for the device came from.